Hi, good morning.
Now we can go for deliberation. Yes.
Probably I am audible now.
Yes, you are audible.
All know about the Doppler effect. This is something related to acoustics. The basic thing is that if a moving object comes to a stationary object, the sound produced by the moving object is having increased intensity, and if it moves away from the stationary object, the reverse also occurs. That is, the intensity of the sound becomes decreased. And in the language of acoustics, this is called frequency shift. And from the frequency shift, there may be calculation of the distance, and from distance we can ultimately determine the velocity. And this is the basics of Doppler. And with this basic concept, we are going to apply this concept in many aspects of echocardiography, which is the ultimate presentation of today's Doppler echocardiography. Doppler echocardiography and 2D echo. The basic difference is that in case of Doppler echocardiography, the line of interrogation and the flow must be parallel. But in case of 2D echo, the essential criterion is to the relationship that is perpendicular. Another one is that the optima is usually lower, but in case of being practical, it must be superimposed on 2D echo. But the 2D echo is relatively independent. It does not need the help of Doppler echo. But for practical information, the two are complementary. Now the types of Doppler. Just I am going to show the common types of Doppler which are being encountered day to day. One is spectral Doppler, which deals with blood flow and which has got two important modalities. One is continuous wave Doppler, another one is pulsed Doppler. The next one is color Doppler. This color Doppler also deals with blood flow. And another very important and emerging one is tissue Doppler. Contrary to the previous two modalities, this tissue Doppler deals with myocardial velocity. So this is not with blood velocity. Now, how can we get Doppler? Many of us are already accustomed with this. However, for getting a Doppler echo, at first we have to ensure a good quality 2D image. And after getting the 2D image, we have to put on color Doppler and or the continuous wave Doppler or pulse wave Doppler. And then we have to place sample volume and cursor placement. And ultimately, we will get the, we have to ensure some other optimization principles. And ultimate result is that we can get a good quality Doppler. And that may be spectral Doppler or that may be color Doppler. Now, spectral Doppler echo. Spectral Doppler echo is a very important modality of Doppler. And whenever we are performing spectral Doppler echo, characteristically we get a typical display like this. This tells us many things. This has got two axes. This is x-axis and this is y-axis. Along the x-axis, time is just mint. And in case of y-axis, the velocity of the flow is determined. The figure also tells us about the direction of the flow. What is this? The basic principle is that direction of the flow, just the location of the transducer is here. And if the flow direction is away from the transducer, it is displayed below the baseline. This straight line is the baseline, and the flow will be displayed below the baseline. And if the direction of the flow is towards the transducer, the reverse is also true, that is, the display will be above the baseline. So this principle applies for the spectral Doppler. Next important information that is from this display is intensity of the flow. I will later discuss whether how can we determine the intensity of the flow. And the next one is nature of the flow can also be assessed by this display. So from this spectral Doppler display, we can have a lot of information that is needed in day-to-day practice. Now, something about pulsed wave Doppler. The pulsed wave Doppler, the basic principle is that pulsed wave Doppler has got one single piezoelectric crystal which is needed for production of ultrasound. And when this piezoelectric crystal produces ultrasonogram wave, it just is transmitted to the object, and after being reflected, that is the reflected wave ultimately returns to that same piezoelectric crystal. So single piezoelectric crystal performs two separate duties in two separate occasions. At first it produces and sends, and then it stops sending and it becomes ready to receive the returned wave. So the two things are not occurring simultaneously, rather they are occurring intermittently. So that is called pulsed wave doppler. Another modality is continuous wave doppler. In case of continuous wave doppler, the piezoelectric crystals are entirely of different sets. So two different sets of piezoelectric crystals are acting. One set is producing ultrasound wave, and thus this wave is being transmitted towards the object. And another set of piezoelectric crystal just receives the returning wave. So the two phenomena occur simultaneously, that is production and reception. So there is no gap between the two phenomena, for which this is called continuous wave doppler. What are the basic differences between the two important spectral Doppler modality? By the way, spectral Doppler modality includes pulsed wave Doppler as well as continuous wave Doppler. The basic difference between the two is that ultrasonogram transmission is, in case of pulsed wave, intermittent, and in case of continuous wave, it is continuous. The sample volume is essentially needed in case of pulsed wave Doppler, and it is very small. And in case of continuous wave Doppler, no sample volume is particularly defined. Rather, a line is defined. Another one is very important property is that pulsed wave Doppler can localize a particular lesion or site, but continuous wave Doppler does not have any property of localization. It interrogates the whole line, not a particular segment of the line. Another important property is Nyquist limit. I will discuss later. Case of pulsed wave Doppler is limited by Nyquist limit, and the consequent of which is aliasing. But in case of continuous wave Doppler, this is not limited by Nyquist limit and aliasing. What is the clinical utility of the pulsed wave Doppler? Basically, pulsed wave Doppler deals with low velocity flow, like normal valve flow, LV diastolic function, venous flow, these things. In case of continuous wave Doppler, high velocity flows are usually interrogated in terms of severity of valvular stenosis and also regurgitation and intracardiac shunts. So there are some basic differences between the two modalities. This is not display of the pulsed wave as well as the continuous wave Dopplers at first look. Now, how can we optimize Doppler? Optimization of Doppler is a prerequisite of having optimum information from spectral Doppler echo and as well as the color Doppler echo. For optimization, there are some important conditions like selection of Doppler modality. We have to decide whether we will take the help of pulsed wave, continuous wave, or color Doppler, or combination of the three. Number one. Number two, we have to ensure good alignment of the Doppler. That is, parallel is the law. And the next one is the optimization of gain, complex, reject, and filter settings. Another important one is, especially in case of pulsed wave Doppler, is the appropriate positioning of the sample volume. I will discuss this in later slides. The next one is setting the scale or baseline, and this is ultimately to change the pulse repetition frequency, that is PRF. We have to adjust the sweep speed in some situations to optimize the envelope. And the last one is optimization of PRF. This is especially needed for wave Doppler as well as for color Doppler, but not for continuous wave Doppler. Now, how can we perform good alignment? What is the importance of alignment? Look at this figure. This is the just beam of interrogation, and this is the object, and this is the direction of the flow. If the angulation between the flow and the blood flow and the ultrasound beam is 0 degree, that is, if the they are totally parallel, this is the most suitable condition, and in that case there will be no error. But in practical settings, this may not always be possible. If not possible, to some extent it can be managed, but if this is beyond the allowable limit, this is not expectable, and ultimately there will be a good error. Say up to 20 degree of angulation between the two may be acceptable in practical purpose, and whenever up to 20 degree angulation occurs, the degree of error is 7%. But when this error occurs, say 90 degree, the error is 100%. So we have to limit the angulation between the ultrasound wave and the flow direction up to 20 degree. If not, then we have to rearrange our settings, or we have to do other maneuvers. There is a scope for angle correction in the modern machines. By means of switching this angle correction tool, we can to some extent minimize the angulation between the two entity, but the recommendation is that this should not routinely be done, because the flow is actually not a linear structure, rather a three-dimensional structure. By performing angle correction, the total optimization may not be possible. So the recommendation have to try in different locations as well as views to ensure the parallel alignment in the practical setting. The next one is optimization of spectral Doppler by manipulation of the gain. What is the importance of gain? Look at the two panels. The left panel, in the left panel, the gain is optimum. And because of the optimum nature of gain, we can distinguish the three velocities separately. This is the velocity, one velocity, this is another one velocity, and this is still another one velocity. But when we are getting the inappropriate setting of the gain, like here, this distinction of the three separate velocities are lost. Just we are getting two velocities, this one and this one. So that this one and this one has been merged together to produce a single velocity. This is undesirable. Another setting is optimization of filter and scale. What is the importance of optimization of the filter? Look at this figure. Here the optimization is not appropriate. And because of the high setting of filter, the diastolic velocity is relatively not appreciable well. But whenever the filter setting is optimum, like here, we can appreciate systolic flow as well as a good diastolic flow. So this is very important in case of some subtle flows by means of manipulation of the filter. Now, the importance of the scale. Look at this, here the scale is not set appropriately. For this region, the overall envelope is of smaller size. Whenever we are seeing this and going to measure the measurements, there may be difficulties. And look at this, here the scale is optimum, so the display is relatively large and we can perform the measurements relatively easily. So this is the importance of adjusting the scale. Now the optimization of the sweep speed. Normally the sweep speed standard is 50 millimeter per second, like the middle one. Whenever the sweep speed is reduced, the complexes will appear rather crowded, like here. And if the sweep speed is adjusted higher, the complexes will be relatively sparse. What is the advantage of manipulation of the sweep speed? Whenever we are going to study the impact of respiratory variation on different types of flows like mitral envelope or the tricuspid envelope like here, if the complexes are rather crowded, then we can easily appreciate the changes with phases of respiration. But in case of air, whenever we are going to study the separate components more closely, in that case we can increase the sweep like here, and this ensures separate illustration of the components of the envelope and ultimately measurement as well. So this is important. Another very, very important practical thing is to ensure appropriate positioning of the sample volume. this is especially important in case of pulse wave Doppler. And if we are not performing the appropriate position of the sample volume, there may be changes in the display of the obtained envelope. Look at this. In many cases of mitral inflow interrogation, the recommended position of the sample volume is at the level of the tip of the mitral valve, like here. If the position is more towards the annulus, from the annulus, the shape of the mitral inflow may vary like this. So whenever we are just going to measure the velocity and ultimately the pressure gradient or other components, there may be significant differences. So we have to ensure appropriate positioning of the mitral, pulse wave sample volume. Now the next discussion is on how to read the spectral Doppler trace. Look at this. There are two basic types of flow. One is laminar flow and another one is turbulent flow. This is the laminar flow, in another name is streamline flow. And this is the turbulence flow, another component of which is eddy current formation. Whenever there is laminar flow, the display of the spectral envelope will be like this. I will discuss this later. And whenever there is turbulent flow, the display typically will be like this. Look at this, there is a central halo in case of laminar flow, but in case of turbulent flow, this is more dense and homogeneous. Now, two important language in relation to the pulse wave Doppler especially. This is the appearance of a typical spectral Doppler envelope obtained by pulse wave. Characteristically, the envelope has got, envelope means just wave. This envelope has got one peripheral denser segment and a central lucent segment. This peripheral denser segment is called spectral width, and the relatively lucent central area is called spectral window. This is the typical finding of interrogation of a laminar flow by pulse wave Doppler. Whenever the flow changes to ultimately turbulent flow, or if this flow, normal flow, is interrogated by continuous wave Doppler, this appearance is lost. Ultimately, there is the envelope becomes more dense, and this peripheral spectral width becomes broader. This phenomenon is called spectral broadening. So spectral broadening signifies two important information. One is, by interrogation by means continuous wave Doppler, even of a normal flow, and another one is presence of turbulent flow in terms of stenotic lesion or like this. This is also very important concept. Look at this. Here, the two tracings are from the same valve, same normal valve, normal mitral valve. This is interrogated by pulse wave and this is by continuous wave. The same phenomenon, but the appearance is like here the previous one, and here this is the more dense one, having spectral broadening. Sometimes the shape of the spectral Doppler matters. Look at this. This is the diagram of the display of the two lesions simultaneously present in case of hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. This is the left ventricular outflow tract obstruction component and the velocity, and this one is the display of the mitral regurgitation component. And these two components both occur in systole, and ultimately they have been displayed one over the another. But if we meticulously observe this, this LVOT obstruction component has got a typical scimitar-like appearance, like this one. And the mitral regurgitation velocity and envelope characteristically assumes the shape of a bell. So this is bell-shaped, and this is scimitar-shaped. So by studying the characteristic shape, we can determine the ultimate origin of the flow or the display. This is the display of the aortic stenosis, that is the valvular stenosis lesion. Its display is like this one, but the LVOT obstruction is displayed, having the display of the shape of the scimitar. So we can just differentiate between the two. The next one, sometimes the spectral Doppler information can give us an impression of the severity of the lesion. Look at the three types of display. All three are from mitral regurgitation lesions. On the left side, the MR is mild, and whenever the MR is mild, the display is just less distinct and not so dense. When this is moderate, that there is a bit improvement of the shape, but still lacking some definition of the apical parts. But whenever the MR is severe, like this one, here the display is more organized and more dense, so more and more RBCs are within the trace and ultimately giving this so well demarcated organized shape. So by viewing these things, we can sometimes have some gauge of the severity of the lesion. This is an interesting phenomenon. So sometimes we can have some additional information by studying the spectral Doppler envelope, like this one. If we go through this envelope, this is from the aortic stenosis lesion, and the aortic stenosis lesion's flow is normally away from the transducer, so it is displayed below the baseline. This is one. And if we go at the tip of the display, the computer software will automatically determine the peak velocity, and from the peak velocity we can get the peak pressure gradient, like this one. And here applies the well-defined modified Bernoulli equation. That is, the pressure gradient is equal to 4 into V squared velocity. This is the spectral Doppler display to determine the mean velocity. Whenever we are going to perform mean velocity, we have to have a good quality spectral Doppler display, and then we have to have a good tracing of the whole envelope, like this one. And whenever we have completed the tracing of this envelope, the software will automatically determine the mean velocity as well as the mean gradient. Besides this, we are getting some additional information by performing these maneuvers. What are those additional information? From this, we will get the velocity, peak gradient, and another most important thing is velocity time integral, that is VTI. I will discuss this later. So by simply tracing this envelope, we will get three or four information simultaneously. What is the importance of getting mean velocity? Practically, the mean velocity is less dependent or influenced by the hemodynamics and also by the heart rate. So this is more desirable as a whole in comparison to the peak velocity, though it is to some extent time consuming. The next one, I have already discussed that we are getting a lot of information, and the information is normally displayed in the computer like this one, echo machine. Another important concept is beard and chin effect. Look at this. This is a display. Certainly the patient is having atrial fibrillation, and if we look at the display, whenever we are going to perform the tracing of this display, we are sometimes confused that whether we will consider this the upper limit of the display, or we will just consider the more dense part or the margin of the display. The recommendation is that we have to avoid the fuzzy part of the display. And this fuzzy part, look at this gentleman, like the beard. And this more dense part is like the chin. So whenever we are performing tracing and ultimately going to determine the peak velocity, mean velocity, or even the PSP, we always look for the more dense part, that is the chin, not the beard, avoiding the beard. Otherwise, there will be overestimation of the velocity as well as the pressure gradient. Now, one important limitation of pulsed wave Doppler is the occurrence of aliasing, and this is due to Nyquist limit. Look at this. This is the wheel. Thus, this wheel is moving down clockwise. Whenever there is a clockwise rotation of this wheel, we are just we are generally sure that the wheel is moving clockwise. But when the speed is still more and increasing, sometimes the human eye cannot determine whether this is moving clockwise or counterclockwise. This is called aliasing. This aliasing also occurs in the field of acoustics. When it occurs in the field of pulsed wave Doppler, the phenomenon like this one here this is the baseline. Look at this, because of the aliasing, some part of the display is become truncated and ultimately displayed in other parts of this recording. So this indicates occurrence of aliasing. Aliasing, why does it occur? It occurred because pulsed wave Doppler interrogates relatively low velocity flows. When this certain maximum limit is crossed, ultimately aliasing occurs. This maximum limit is called Nyquist limit. And the relationship between Nyquist limit and pulse repetition frequency is that the PRF is equal to half of the PRF is equal to Nyquist limit. So this is a limitation, important limitation of pulse wave Doppler. Overcome this, I will just going to this phenomenon. How can we overcome this? That is by we can get rid of aliasing. There are several recommendations. Number one is that we can change the Nyquist limit, that is the velocity scale. Number one. Number two, we can shift baseline to up or low, below, so that we can increase the Nyquist limit. Number three, we can activate high PRF mode. And if all these things do not work, in that case, we can actually switch to continuous wave Doppler. So this is another option. Look at this. Just we have, by this time, we have heard the term of high PRF mode, that is high pulse repetition frequency mode. This is nothing but one type of pulsed wave Doppler having a bit more efficient to study higher velocity flows. And when the switch is turned on, like here, there is we are seeing the occurrence of aliasing, and some part of the display has been truncated and overlapped with the velocity. And even by changing the baseline, the aliasing still persists. But whenever the PRF mode is on, turned on, this aliasing is not still presenting, and ultimately we are having a beautiful display of the pulsed wave Doppler envelope. So this is another way of getting rid of aliasing. Spectral Doppler envelope, from the spectral Doppler envelope, we can have a number of additional informations. Like we can calculate the acceleration time. What is acceleration time? Acceleration time is the time which is taken for getting to the peak, that is from the beginning up to reaching the peak of the display. This time is called acceleration time. And this acceleration time has got a number of clinical applications, like whenever we are going to study the obstructed, say prosthetic, acceleration time gets increased in case of sick obstruction. Another counterpart is presence of deceleration time. What is deceleration time? The reverse is also true. Just if we consider the time taken from the peak to up to reaching the baseline for the reduction of the flow, gradual decreasing of the flow, the time taken is called the deceleration time. This will be calculated from the peak, just drawing a perpendicular line up to the base, and ultimately the gap between this perpendicular line and the intersection between the extrapolation of the descending limb with the axis baseline. So this is the deceleration time. This deceleration time again has got some important applications, like we can readily memorize this application in case of studying the diastolic dysfunction of the left ventricle. Look at this. In comparison to this one, here the deceleration time is reduced. Now, another very important time is pressure half time. As we are all accustomed with studying the severity of the mitral stenosis, one of the important way to assess the severity of mitral stenosis is to have the pressure half time. And by just switching the specific knob, we can ultimately get a display here, mitral valve envelope. And when the two points are met, we can have the pressure half time automatically. Another important application of pressure half time is to assess the severity of aortic regurgitation. Look at this. This is a beautiful envelope of the aortic regurgitation, just more or less moderate to severe AR. And whenever we are performing this pressure half time study, it will give us some assessment of the severity of the aortic regurgitation. The more the pressure half time value in case of aortic regurgitation, the lesser the degree or severity of AR. The reverse is also true. We can also get some other important intervals. I am not going into details. Now, one interesting phenomenon here. Sometimes we encounter when we are performing spectral Doppler echocardiography, two separate velocities superimposed one over the other, like here. This patient is having just two velocities. This is the aortic regurgitation velocity, and this is the velocity by the this is due to why does this occur? This occur if sometimes we interrogate the two valves or the two areas simultaneously with a sample volume. In that case, such phenomenon occur. This is called double beam width artifact, and this is sometimes a problem. The next important section I am going to highlight is color Doppler flow mapping. This is important. We all know that color Doppler is nothing but one type of special type of pulsed wave Doppler. In case of pulsed wave, just single sample volume is employed, but in case of color Doppler, a number of gating is used. Color Doppler is not independent. For color Doppler, presence of a good quality 2D image is a must. Like here, we are just seeing this. One Doppler is that it obeys the law of BART, BART principle. It is blue away and red towards. If a flow is from away from the transducer, this will be displayed as blue. And if the flow is towards the transducer, then it will appear red color. I will highlight this. Look at this. There are two displays from the same lesion, that is the same valve, and this is the alveolar flow from LV to aorta. There is a flow, and if we look at the position of the transducer towards the transducer, so it assumes red. The same patient, same alveolar flow, when interrogated from the apical position, the direction here of the flow is away from the transducer, so it is blue. So this relationship more or less maintained. Look at this color disc display recording. Here there are several important messages from this. This one, look at this, the whole area is called the focus, and within the focus we will get a 2D image like this one, and the 2D image details are displayed in the grayscale here, mentioned here. And in the 2D image of the heart, we are particularly concerned with a defined area. This is called sector width. The sector width ultimately studies the color Doppler interrogation, performs the color Doppler interrogation as is here. And the details of color Doppler interrogation is present in this scale, that is the colored scale mentioned here. So we will ultimately study these things in the next slide. For color Doppler, two types of scales are important. One is velocity mapping or scale, another one is variance scale. What is the importance? Velocity mapping is important because that whether my velocity, that is the blood flow velocity, is away from the transducer or towards the transducer. If there is no flow, the center will be relatively black or white like this one. And if the flow is towards the transducer, there will be red display. The highest velocity is displayed towards the periphery and having the lighter shades. The reverse is also true in case of blue shades. Look at here, there is a definite number here. This number is the maximum number, that is the maximum limit defined by the setup. And this is called the Nyquist limit in case of color Doppler. So unlike continuous wave Doppler, but like pulsed wave Doppler, color Doppler has got definite Nyquist limit. Here we can change this. We can also change the baseline. We can shift this upwards or shift this downwards according to our necessity. Another one is that if we go back to this display here, besides the red and blue color, there are some mixed of colors, that is the riots of, but there is occurrence turbulent flow due to maybe increased velocity or due to stenosis or regurgitation, there will be not merely red and blue display. Rather, there needs to be display of a mixture of colors. This, to display the mixture of colors, another scale is needed. This scale is called Arian's scale. So this is for especially for turbulent flow display, and the different shapes and color of the turbulent flow is indicated here. Color Doppler echo is limited by occurrence of aliasing like pulse wave Doppler. Say this one here, the flow is from the transducer away. So according to the BART principle, it will display as blue. Look at this. Besides blue, there are also red component. Red component. What is the importance of this red component? The importance of this red component is that because of the crossing the maximum limit of interrogation of this color Doppler, ultimately there is aliasing of the color, changing the color ultimately to the opposite direction. That is, it has assumed the red color. Also, beyond blue, there are some mixture of colors. This is due to the occurrence of the turbulent flow due to the increased velocity. How can we optimize the color Doppler setting? For optimization, we have to ensure parallel alignment, number one. Number two, we have to increase the frame rate. How can we increase the frame rate? Basically, we can narrow the color scan sector width. That is, if we go here, this is the sector width. We should not unnecessarily increase the sector width. If we increase the sector width, there will be change of the frame rate. Frame rate will be reduced. So by making it narrower, we can increase the frame rate, which is desirable in most of the situations. Now we can reduce the depth of the color scan sector. If we reduce the depth of the color scan sector, the sound wave has to travel less distance, so there will be increase in the PRF and ultimately frame rate will be increased. Another important optimization is to optimize the gain. Gain should be optimized. Nyquist limit should be optimized. For most of the purposes, the optimum Nyquist limit setting is 50 to 70 centimeter per second. If we are going to interrogate very low velocity flow, like venous flow or the diastolic dysfunction flows, in those cases, sometimes we have to reduce this to 30 to 35 or maximum 40 centimeter per second. And certainly we have to avoid artifacts. I'm not going into detail. I have already mentioned the optimum Nyquist limit setting for different purposes. Now I am entering into arena of Doppler formulas and methods. This is a bit tricky things. One is, by this time we have learned how to have or obtain VTI. For getting the VTI, and if we perform the tracing, we trace the display, ultimate computer will give us a value in centimeter. This is called VTI, that is velocity time integral. The another synonym of which is stroke distance. So this is also called stroke distance. What does it actually indicate? It actually indicates the how far blood travels with each systole. So the distance traveled by the blood with its systole is called stroke distance. And in another words, in the term of spectral Doppler, this is called VTI, velocity time integral. We can determine velocity time integral whatever in whatever segment or area we like. The customarily, we are more interested to have the LVOT VTI, the aortic valve VTI, mitral level valve level VTI. These types of VTI sometimes we need to determine. Say, for determination of LVOT VTI, we have to go to a 5-chamber or apical 3-chamber view, and we have to use pulsed wave Doppler, because if we use continuous wave Doppler, it will more easily take up the velocity at the level of aortic valve rather than at the level of LVOT. So we have to use pulsed wave Doppler to ensure our position. The next one is placement of the sample volume within the LVOT. the current recommendation is to placement of the sample volume 5 millimeter proximal to the aortic valve. And whenever we have done all the things, there will be a nice display of the LVOT envelope like this one. And now our duty is to planimeter this trace. And whenever we have performed planimeter of the trace, there will be just automatic display of the PTI of the LVOT. The next one, we have to have the LVOT diameter. What is the recommendation? Recommendation is that we have to have flux view, that is parasternal long axis view. This should be zoomed up for convenience. And the recommendation is to perform in mid-systole. And this should be from 3 to 10 millimeter away from the insertion of the aortic valve cusps with the aortic wall. So we have to go far from this point to this point. And then we have to measure or draw a straight line from inner edge to get the correct LVOT diameter. To have the correct LVOT diameter is a very vital one. Otherwise, all the calculations will be wrong or distorted. How can we get a mitral valve VTI? For getting the mitral valve VTI, again, we have to have a good quality apical four chamber view, and then we have to use pulse to wave Doppler, and the sample volume should be placed at the level of mitral valve annulus. Mind it, mitral valve annulus, not at the level of tip of mitral valve. In most of the other situations, we are interested for placing the sample volume at the level of tip of the mitral valve, but here, the essential criterion is to place the sample volume at the level of mitral valve annulus. So this is a must or prerequisite. Whenever we have got a good quality display, then we have to perform planimeterization, and ultimately we will get mitral valve PTI automatically by the computer. The next one, like LVOT diameter, how can we get mitral valve diameter? For getting mitral valve diameter, again, the recommendation is to adopt the apical four chamber view. And then at the level of the annulus, we have to perform inner edge to inner edge measurement. And this will give mitral valve diameter for the subsequent calculations. Ultimate motto of just getting the VTI and the diameters is to have the practical informations like stroke volume. For stroke volume, which is normally 50 to 90 milliliter, we can apply some formulas. The simplified formula is, in case of LVOT VTI, for LVOT stroke volume, the formula is 0.785 into LVOT diameter, which we have already determined, into LVOT VTI, which we have already got by this time. In a similar manner, we can determine stroke volume at the level of mitral valve. The same formula, 0.785 into mitral valve diameter into mitral valve PTI. All these values by this time are in our hand, so we can determine the stroke volume easily, non-invasively. The next important one is, how can we determine cardiac output? As we know from our physiology knowledge is that cardiac output is nothing but the combination of stroke volume and heart rate. When stroke volume is multiplied by heart rate, we get cardiac output. Similarly, we are interested in having cardiac index. Cardiac index, if we put the two informations within the echo machine, that is the height and weight of the patient, the machine will automatically determine the body surface area, and it will ultimately determine the cardiac index in the term of cardiac output per square meter of body surface area. So these are possible by means of Doppler echocardiography. One vital equation that is needed in case of Doppler is continuity equation. This is simple. The basic principle is that within a closed circuit or even in open circuit, the basic principle is what goes in must come out. So what goes in must come out. So if we know the velocity or the blood flow in a segment, we can determine the velocity in and the ultimate blood flow in another segment, whether it is narrow or dilated. They are interrelated. And the basic formula is that area 1 into velocity 1 is equal to area 2 into velocity 2. if we know three values, we can determine the fourth one, which may be unknown. What is the application of continuity equation? The basic applications of continuity equations are to assessment of hull area for assessing ultimately the stenosis severity. And the next one is regurgitation volume determination, which is for assessing the regurgitation severity. And another very important is for shunt calculation, that is QPQS ratio, we can determine by applying continuity equation. I will highlight briefly in the subsequent sections. For determination of aortic valve area by continuity equation, we have to have some important values, which by this time we have already determined. One important one is LVOT diameter. We know how we can get this from the flux view. Another one is LVOT VTI in centimeter, which we have already determined this by means of pulse wave Doppler. And another one is aortic valve VTI. We can have this in a similar manner. And whenever we have got the three values, we can apply this formula, 0.785 into LVOT diameter into LVOT VTI divided by aortic valve VTI. So by this calculation, we will ultimately get the aortic valve area. So this is not a very tough job. If we practice regularly, we can be accustomed. In a similar manner, we can get mitral valve area by continuity equation. Though in the practical field, unlike aortic valve area, mitral valve area is less often interrogated by means of continuity equation, because other values are, other ways are already in our hand. Here, the 0.785 into LVOT VTI into LVOT diameter divided by mitral valve VTI. We can get mitral valve area. Now, another important application is to calculate the regurgitant fraction. We can calculate, the basic principle is that normally stroke volume across the aortic valve is equal to stroke volume across mitral valve. This is logical. If no valve incompetent and no intercardiac shunt. If one valve is incompetent, laver gur pipray khabe, in that case, there will be increased volume across the incompetent valve. So in that case, two stroke volumes will not be equal. By deducting one from the another, we can easily determine the regurgitant volume. So the regurgitant volume is the ultimate value obtained by this formula, that is regurgitant volume is equal to stroke volume across the incompetent valve minus stroke volume across the competent valve. Whenever we have obtained regurgitant volume, we can determine regurgitant fraction by applying simple math. What is that? Regurgitant fraction is equal to regurgitant volume divided by stroke volume across the incompetent valve, mind it, incompetent valve. So this is the regurgitant fraction. These are the one of the tools for assessment of regurgitation severity in case of aortic regurgitation, mitral regurgitation like this. And an important application is shunt flow calculation. Shunt flow calculation basically relies on the principle is that normally stroke volume across pulmonary valve is equal to stroke volume across aortic valve. And stroke volume across RVOT is equal to stroke volume across LVOT. If no valve is incompetent and no shunt. If there is shunt, along the direction of the shunt, there will be increased flow. Mind it, respiration has got important impact on all these parameters. So whenever we are going to calculate shunt flow, the basic formula is RVOT stroke volume divided by LVOT stroke volume. We can just easily determine. And shunt flow ultimately is 0.785 into RVOT diameter square into RVOT VTI divided by 0.785 into LVOT diameter square into LVOT VTI. These things we have already got in the previous discussion. Another application which is favored by invasive assessment, that is the catheterization, we can to some extent get by means of applying the Doppler principle, that is pulmonary vascular resistance. It will help us deciding whether we are sending the patient for surgery or not. The well-known formula is Abbas formula. In case of Abbas formula, we can get PVR by applying tricuspid regurgitation maximum velocity divided by RVOT VTI into 10 plus 0.16, and the ultimate number will be expressed in Woods unit. Normal value is up to 1.5 Woods unit. Pulmonary hypertension signifies when the value exceeds 3. Now, we have entered into the discussion of hemodynamics. What we have already discussed has covered major parts of hemodynamics. But one important part is already left. What is that part? I am not going into the pulmonary vein Doppler. I am intentionally skipping this. I am not going into the flow reversal in descending thoracic aorta. But I am interested in going into the invasive assessment which is needed in case of CCU management as well as for ICU management. I have no doubt to recognize that invasive monitoring is the gold standard, but side by side, invasive monitoring has got a number of hassles, like painful, needs more expertise, and also it carries more chance of infection and other hazards. For this reason, present time, in many cases, avoid invasive monitoring by applying the principles of Doppler echocardiography. In case of hemodynamic monitoring, we are specially concerned with three or four values. One is central venous pressure monitoring, number one. Another one is monitoring of the pulmonary capillary waist pressure. And if you are willing to know another important parameter, I like to add assessment of the pulmonary artery pressures. Now I am going to discuss one by one. We all know that we can accustom with calculation of the right atrial pressure, which is the most simple practice is that we are going to assume this as 10, and with all the measurements, we are going to add 10. But the matter is not so simple. We have simply oversimplified this. We have to customize it according to the situations. What is the importance of determination of right atrial pressure? Because right atrial pressure indicates the central venous pressure. What is the importance of central venous pressure? The central venous pressure tells us about the volume status, overall volume status of the patient, whether we are going to give volume or we are going to just diuretic diuresis to get rid of volume. These decisions may be very important. And for assessment of the right atrial pressure, we have to depend on the inferior vena cava. For this, we employ the subcostal view like this one. And in that case, we will get a beautiful display of the inferior vena cava and the part of the right atrium when it enters into the right atrium. For the calculation, we have to adopt the long axis of the inferior vena cava, number one. Number two, we have to get the diameter of the inferior vena cava just proximal to the opening of the hepatic vein. This is the hepatic vein, and we have to determine the diameter of the inferior vena cava just proximal to the opening of the hepatic vein. So here this is the appropriate point. Another recommendation is that we can just determine the diameter 1 to 2 centimeters proximal to the opening into the right atrium. This is another recommendation. So both are acceptable. What is the interpretation? For interpretation, we consider two parameters. One is the diameter of the inferior vena cava, which already we have determined. Another important is the behavior of the inferior vena cava with respiration and sniffing. What is sniffing? Sniffing is sudden performing the inspiration, forceful inspiration is called sniffing. So in case of normal situation, the diameter of the inferior vena cava should not exceed 20 millimeter, irrespective of the body surface area of the patient. And the normal behavior of the inferior vena cava with the phases of respiration and sniffing is that in case of sniffing, it should collapse at least 50%. That is more than 50% collapsibility is the normal expectation. In case of quiet respiration, when the patient cannot sniff, the value is 20%. So we have to know also the 20%. The interpretation is that when the diameter is normal, diameter of IVC is normal, and collapsibility is more than 50%, we should think of right atrial pressure 3 millimeters. when the diameter is normal but the collapsibility is less than 50% with sniffing, the value is 8 millimeter. When the diameter of the inferior vena cava is more than 20 millimeter but the collapsibility is more than 50%, then the value is again 8 millimeter. When the diameter is increased, that is IVC is dilated and collapsibility is lost, that is everything is abnormal, then the right atrial pressure is 15 millimeter. So this is the current recommendation. Here, this already has been discussed. In case of this patient, here we are seeing the collapsibility of the inferior vena cava and the diameter of the inferior vena cava is also okay. So in that case, we are adding just getting 3 millimeter and here the 8 millimeter. I have already discussed. In this case, the inferior vena cava is dilated and it has lost the collapsibility. So both are abnormal. When both parameters are abnormal, at least right atrial pressure is 15 millimeter, or it may be even more than 15 millimeter. What are the limitations of sniff test? The problem is that it needs patient cooperation, number one. Number two, tachycardia is a problem. Number three, mechanical ventilation may impair with the interpretation. And number four is that there is lack of standardization of inspiratory effort. How much inspiratory effort will be enough? There is no standardization. Now, I am going to illustrate how we can determine pulmonary artery pressures. Mind it, there are three types of pulmonary artery pressures. One is pulmonary artery systolic pressure, we call it PASP. Another one is PADP, pulmonary artery diastolic pressure. And the third one is mean pulmonary artery pressure. Luckily, by applying the Doppler principles, we can have all the three types of pulmonary pressures with much reliability, and which correlate with cardiac cath data. A number of formulas are available for determining the different pressures, but I confine my discussion with to several formulas, well-known formulas or more practice formulas only. Whenever we are going to perform the PASP, that is pulmonary artery systolic pressure, in absence of stenosis in the pulmonary valve or RVOT or tricuspid valve, right ventricular systolic pressure is equal to pulmonary artery systolic pressure. For getting pulmonary artery systolic pressure, we have to have a good quality apical four chamber view, and we have to have a good quality TR jet. And if we interrogate the TR jet with continuous wave Doppler, mind it, continuous wave Doppler, with all the criteria, we will ultimately get a beautiful display of the TR jet below the baseline. And by going to the apex, we can get the peak TR velocity, like here. And then we can apply the Bernoulli equation, modified Bernoulli equation. And when we are going to apply this equation, ultimately we will get the pressure gradient between the RV and the RA. And if with this, we add the right atrial pressure, ultimately we will get the right ventricular systolic pressure, right ventricular systolic pressure. In absence of pulmonary stenosis or RVOT stenosis, this will represent the PASP ultimately. So we can get PASP by this means. Sometimes the practical scenario is that there is some sort of RVOT or pulmonary artery stenosis. If this is present, still we can guess the PASP by applying the same TR principles. What is that? If PASP, pulmonary stenosis, is present, PASP will be equal to right ventricular systolic pressure minus PS gradient. Minus PS gradient. Mind it, this is very practical. Next, if we have a VSD patient and we can have a good quality alignment so that the VSD jet is just parallel to the ultrasound beam in any of the available window, we can luckily calculate PASP. What is the formula? We can have PASP. We have to have another information, that is the systolic blood pressure of the patient. We can easily get this by applying blood pressure machine at the level of the arm. And whenever we are measuring the blood pressure, we should consider systolic blood pressure. From the systolic blood pressure, we have to deduct 4 into peak VSD gradient. That is the peak gradient here. So from the systolic blood pressure, we have to deduct 4 into VAP GSD gradient squares. And the result is, that is the value will represent the PASP. So in case of a suitable PSD patient, by these principles, we can calculate PASP. How can we get RV diastolic pressure? If there is no TS, that is tricuspid stenosis, the RV diastolic pressure will be equal to right atrial pressure. If there is TS, that is tricuspid stenosis, RV diastolic pressure will be RA pressure minus TS gradient. So this is also practical and important. The next one is pulmonary artery diastolic pressure, PADP. For PADP and for mean pulmonary artery pressure, we have to have a good quality parasternal short axis view at the level of blood vessels. And if we luckily have a certain level of PR, pulmonary regurgitation, and then we will interrogate the pulmonary regurgitation, and ultimately we will get a spectral Doppler envelope above the baseline. Luckily, this may have got two important points. One is indicating the maximum velocity, and this is the minimum diastolic velocity. So these two values are very important. By applying this one, we will get mean velocity, and by applying this one, we will get the diastolic velocity. The formula is that PADP is equal to 4 into PR minimum, that is that this one, PR minimum square plus right atrial pressure, plus right atrial pressure. So this will give us the PADP. And without considering this, if we just consider this point, that is the maximum PR velocity, and we apply the formula here, 4 into PR max square plus right atrial pressure, we will easily get the mean pulmonary artery pressure. So this is not very tough job. We can have mean pulmonary artery pressure by other means as well. We can sometimes get this by means of TRZ. What is the relationship? Mean pulmonary artery pressure is equal to 0.61 into PASP plus 2. 0.61 into PASP plus 2. So if just we know the PASP, ultimately by applying this formula, we can determine the mean pulmonary artery pressure. And in case of a PDA patient, we can get the pulmonary artery diastolic pressure, going into the details. For the sake of simplicity, I am also avoiding the measurement of LA pressure. The next one, I am going to do how we can invasively calculate pulmonary capillary waist pressure. This is one of the bread and butters for the ICU specialists. So ICU persons are interested in having the PCWP, that is pulmonary capillary waist pressure value. Why? Because this indicates the left atrial pressure, and also this indicates the left ventricular filling pressure. So this is important. There are several options, but the one of the most popular formula is Nege formula. By applying the Nege formula, we can easily get the pulmonary capillary waist pressure non-invasively. For this, we have to study the mitral inflow in apical four chamber view by means of pulse to wave Doppler, like this one, and we have to take the help of tissue Doppler. We have to determine the just tissue Doppler velocity like this one, having E prime max and the A prime. From these two values, we are actually practicing regularly. We can apply the formula like pulmonary capillary waist pressure is equal to 1.9 plus 1.24 into E by E prime. This is not a tough job. Pulmonary capillary waist pressure is equal to 1.9 plus 1.24 into E by E prime. So by getting these simple two parameters, that is the E and the E prime velocity, we will ultimately get the pulmonary capillary waist pressure. We can also determine left ventricular end diastolic pressure. I am not going into details. This is less important. I have already mentioned more or less this, and this is also will be discussed in case of diastolic dysfunction assessment. I am not going into this. A few words regarding the PISA. PISA is theoretically quite important for assessment of valve rigor detection and to some extent valve stenosis. But practically, this may not be so convenient in a busy lab. But we have some idea regarding what is PISA. PISA is a peculiar phenomenon. When liquid flows through a circular orifice like this one, this is a circular orifice, one interesting phenomenon occurs. That is, before crossing the circular orifice, the flow will converge. That is, meet together. And whenever flow will converge, there will be increase in velocity near the orifice, and there will be formation of some concentric shells of velocity like this one. This one shell, another shell, another shell, still another shell. Ultimately, there will be formation of several shells. Whenever formation of these several shell occurs, the total area confined by these concentric shells of velocity is called PISA. That is proximal isovelocity surface area. The interesting phenomenon is that within the PISA, within the in each shell of the PISA, the velocity will be similar. That is isovelocity. The velocity will be similar. We can conveniently measure the diameter of this PISA from this narrowest part, from this area, and also by applying the formula, we can determine the area covered by the PISA. And we can apply ultimately this diameter and this diameter and this area for determining the detail of the valvular ligature detection and stenosis by applying different formulas. Just I am at the end of my presentation. What important message I am going to give you is that actually, whenever we are dealing with a valve stenosis or area stenosis, in case of valve stenosis, the stenosis is not located in a single point always. Why? Because anatomy and physiology does not go hand in hand. Anatomy, physiology, and within the physiology, invasive physiology and non-invasive physiology does not go hand in hand. This is the true anatomical area, that is the valve area. But echo area a bit changed from here within the, say in case of aortic orifice, this is within the root of the aorta, that is here. And cath is still more beyond the anatomical area, that is here, this is the cath. So when cath considers, the area is here. When echo considers, the area is here. And when anatomy considers, the actual location is rather here. So this is an interesting and important consideration. But whenever we are performing the selective modality, we are actually dealing with that area. But practical purpose, we are intermingling all the three areas for clinical application. With this, I like to conclude my today's presentation. Thank you all for patient hearing of a so boring presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Manohar. It was a brilliant presentation. We all enjoyed this presentation. And now this is a time for question and answer session.
I'm going to talk.
Yes, sir.
Manohar has made a very brilliant presentation, no doubt of it, but he crossed ABC. He goes to the QRST. He was supposed to present the ABC of Doppler, but he goes up to the QRST. Anyway, it is very interesting. He made it very interesting. He does not make it boring. So it is a good credit. Not that he says many things, rather he makes it very simple way. Anyway, I will request the fellows to participate in asking questions. Dr. Firoz?
Yes, sir. Sir,
you cannot take the questions from the fellows.
We have got some questions already. I will encourage our fellows to send more questions in the question and answer box or the chat box. Our first question is Dr. Khairul Kobi. why planimetry is not applicable for alcohol, Dr. Manohar?
Why planimetry is not applicable? This is an important question. Just in case of mitral valve, we are very, very interested to perform planimetry. The problem is that in case of adults, aortic valve cannot be just interrogated by means of planimetry so easily because of the anatomy and inability to get this in the profile view. And another important thing is that whenever there is disease in terms of, say, calcification, that there is so irregularity that heart can get area calculate the planimetry. But certainly with the advancement of 3D echocardiography, sometimes we can calculate the area by planimetry, and also sometimes by transesophageal echocardiography, we can to some extent be able to perform planimetry.
Thank you, Dr. Manohar. Next question from Dr. Rashidul Hassan. How shall shunt calculation done? I think we have discussed this part, how we can calculate the QP and QS. Dr. Manohar, do you want to add something?
I think what is the problem is that in day-to-day practice, we do not do usually shunt calculation by echo. But if we are accustomed, as I have already displayed, that this is not a very tough job. It needs just few parameters, and this can be achieved even in a busy lab. We can ultimately get non-invasively the shunt calculation.
Yes, the important thing that you need to have very good measurement of the LVOT diameter and RVOT diameter, and the two right. important VTIs at the level of the RVOT and at the level of the LVOT. Right. Sometimes the RVOT is difficult to visualize and LVOT is easy to visualize, and the shape of these RVOT is also important. That is a more advanced thing.
I like to add one important practical thing. As Dr. Firoz Bhai has already mentioned, that sometimes it may be very difficult to obtain a good quality RVOT. If as is the usual choice, is parasternal short axis view at the level of great vessels, where we can just determine the diameter of the RVOT just proximal to the pulmonary valve. If this is not so clear, we can take the help of parasternal long axis view in the modified form, that is the RV outflow view. Sometimes yes. we can measure the RVOT diameter there.
Yes, we have shown it on the first lecture. How right ventricular function affect PSP? I think our next lecture is regarding right ventricular function. The next Friday, we'll discuss more about it. But Dr. Manohar, you can add something.
Yes, I like to give the important message is that in case of significant right ventricular systolic dysfunction, actually we may not get a very good quality TR signal. This may be one important limitation. Another important limitation, in case of severe tricuspid regurgitation, there may be so non-cooperation of the tricuspid valve leaflets is that there may be equalization of the pressure between RA and RV. In exactly. those cases, also the formula applies less efficiently.
So another important thing is regarding the RA pressure. You have mentioned that it is either 3.8 or more than 15. Does it indicate RA systolic, diastolic, or mean pressure? What does it indicate?
This is very important. This is actually mean pressure, RA mean pressure.
Exactly. This indicates the RA mean pressure, or to be more specific, pre-atrial systolic pressure.
Right.
The pressure in the RA before atrial systolic, that is the 3.8 or 15. And right. the important thing is if more than 15, that means it can be 20, it can be 25, it can be right. 30, it can be anything. So you can, if you add 15, on that case, you can mention that the pulmonary artery systolic pressure is more than 60. It can be anything more than 60. It can be more than 80, like this. So that is to be mentioned.
আমি একটু অ্যাড করতে যাচ্ছি
তোমার আগামী তোমার নেক্সট উইকে সম্ভাবনা আছে
না বেশি বলছি না স্যার এই যে এখানে যেটা হচ্ছে রাইট আট্রিয়াল প্রেসার স্যার যেটা হচ্ছে কি আমরা বলছি স্যার 3.5 8.15 স্যার
এটা কি তোমার লেকচারে বললে ভালো হবে না চানা
আজকে
তো না তোমার এখানে বললে মানে গ্রেস করতে সুবিধা হবে
আচ্ছা ঠিক আছে
বলছো খালি আউটলাইন বলছে
না না ঠিক আছে অসুবিধা
অ্যানাদার কোশ্চেন ফ্রম ডক্টর তুফাইলউদ্দিন আহমেদ উইদাউট টিআর হাউ ক্যান উই মেজার পালমোনারি হাইপারটেনশন
আই হ্যাভ অলরেডি দ্য কারেন্ট ওয়ান ইম্পর্ট্যান্ট কারেন্ট রিকমেন্ডেশন ইজ দ্যাট হোয়েনেভার উই আর ক্যালকুলেটিং পালমোনারি আর্টারি সিস্টোলিক প্রেশার বাই অ্যাপ্লাইং দ্য ফর্মুলা ডিপেন্ডেন্ট অন টিআর অ্যান্ড রাইট এট্রিয়াল প্রেশার দেয়ার ইজ এ চান্স অফ সিগনিফিক্যান্ট এরর অ্যান্ড ফর দিস রিজন দ্য কারেন্ট রিকমেন্ডেশন বাই দ্য ইউরোপিয়ান সোসাইটি অফ ইকোকার্ডিওগ্রাফি ইজ দ্যাট উই আর মোর ইন্টারেস্টেড ইন ডিলিং উইথ দ্য পাপিক পালমোনারি প্রেশার দ্যাট ইজ দ্য পিক পালমোনারি ভেলোসিটি নট দ্য প্রেশার not the pressure velocity rather so the current recommendation is that whether it is within 2.8 meter per second or more than 3.4 meter
that
per
second there is a TR
right peak TR velocity is exactly. more recommended yes. nowadays
but you can guess in the other ways by measuring the pulmonary artery diastolic pressure pulmonary artery mean pressure
yes I have shown so many options exactly. and formulas okay.
and also pulmonary artery acceleration pulmonary acceleration right. time
pulmonary acceleration
that will give you the idea whether this pulmonary hypertension is there or not but it yes. will not quantify the exact pulmonary artery pressure
exactly
question from Dr. Rahatul Qadir how we can take aortic valve VTI
aortic valve VTI we have to just apply the continuous wave Doppler in apical 5-chamber view or yes. apical 3-chamber view, the another name of which is apical long axis view, and then we have to switch on continuous wave Doppler, and we have to ensure that the outflow and the beam is parallel, ultrasound beam is parallel, and then we will get a good quality aortic flow below the baseline, and we can then perimeter this trace. And ultimately, automatically, the computer will give the information of aortic valve VTI.
In fact, in your lecture, it was mentioned as pulse wave Doppler. Probably that's why he has asked about how we can.
In case of aortic valve, it is continuous wave Doppler. In case of LVOT, pulse wave Doppler.
Pulse wave Doppler, exactly. In case of Dr. Rehan asked, HOCM detected by pulse wave Doppler or continuous wave Doppler?
Good question. In case of HOCM, the first thing is that the obstruction is at the level of LVOT. So whenever there is obstruction at the level of LVOT, if we apply continuous wave Doppler, there will be interrogation through which will include the aortic valve as well. So the display, that is the envelope, will represent the level of obstruction at the level of aortic valve as well as at the level of LVOT. Sometimes this is needed because the pulse wave Doppler has got important positive property, another important negative property. The positive property is that it can be placed at the level of LVOT, obstructed LVOT. So it can give the obstruction, location of the obstruction. But the problem is that it has got Nyquist limit. If the obstruction is significant, then just only placing the pulse wave will not be, the velocity will not be demonstrated equally. So in those cases, we have to utilize both the modalities. That is, by applying the continuous wave Doppler, we can have the whole gradient with a characteristic scimitar shape. We can have the idea that the obstruction is at the level of the LVOT. And when we have got this, we can then apply the pulse wave Doppler. We can place the sample volume from up to the down, and ultimately the exact site of the increment of the velocity will give us idea of the LVOT obstruction. Am I correct?
Exactly. The continuous wave Doppler is for quantification of the gradient. How much severe is the gradient? And the pulse wave Doppler is for the localization of the flow acceleration at the point of stenosis or acceleration of the gradient. That's what you are trying to say, I think. Doppler findings of ASB, why this type of phenomenon occurs?
Doppler findings of?
ASB. Probably he is trying to say the pulse wave Doppler spectrum in case of ASD across the entire.
In case of pulse ASD, if we are interrogating the ASD in the subcostal view in case of adults or any person, and if we are lucky enough to have a parallel alignment, in that case the flow is laminar, and characteristically the flow has got three phases, that is the tricuspid flow. And whenever we are picking the tricuspid flow at the level of the gap in the interatrial septum by means of pulse wave doppler, we will get characteristic triphasic flow having the Zhou Dutch appearance. So this will give rise to the characteristic triphasic flow. And today, in the availability, due to the availability of the color Doppler, virtually we have forgotten the contribution of spectral Doppler echo for the diagnosis of ASD.
Exactly, thank you. Another question from Dr. Kaniz Ananda. Significance of regurgitant volume. I think it will be discussed in mitral regurgition, right, and aortic regurgition. We have got two lectures out, regurgitant volume.
Just in plain language, the regurgitant volume determination is one of the few tools for the echocardiographer to assess the severity of regurgitant lesion.
Exactly. Dr. Azizul Haq Sohel, please discuss about instantaneous peak-to-peak gradient and pressure recovery phenomenon.
This is of more theoretical interest than for practical interest. The thing is that whenever we are dealing with, say, echocardiography, whenever we are determining the peak velocity, at the point of time we are determining the maximum velocity. It is that instantaneous gradient at that time. But whenever we are dealing with mean velocity, a number of instantaneous gradients are determined, and then the software will determine a mean, calculate a mean from that instantaneous gradients. This will ultimately give rise to mean gradient.
Thank you. And the pressure recovery is more tough. We'll listen in the lecture of aortic stenosis, if possible, about the pressure recovery phenomenon. So how to measure the LVEDP?
LVDP. LVDP, just one important thing is that if there is no obstruction between atrium, left atrium and left ventricle, like if you are not dealing with a case of mitral stenosis, in that actually the LVDP and left atrial pressure will be same. So for practical purposes, if we determine left atrial pressure, and in other words, pulmonary capillary waist pressure, virtually these three pressures are almost equal for all practical purposes.
Exactly. And regarding the measurement of mean LA pressure, you have mentioned about the Nagoe formula.
Right.
This is my question to you. Is it appropriate in all cases, or it is well validated or not?
None of the formulas which are dependent on so many calculations are entirely dependable. So they are not the replacement of invasive monitoring, but in many situations, especially when there is no marked changes in heart rate, volume status, we can rely on this.
Because there are so many criticism of this Nagoe formula regarding the LVEDP. And many of the pioneers, many of the authors don't agree with him. It's rather the E by E prime ratio. If it is more than 15, that means your PCW is high. If it is less than 8, it is normal.
The problem is that we cannot determine the exact value. Sometimes we are interested in having the value, whether it is 6, 10 or 40. In that case, Nagoe formula may be a good option.
But many of the authors do not agree.
Right. I agree with you.
So another question. What is the wonderful presentation? Difference between AS and MR envelope in continuous wave doppler.
AS and MR.
It is from Dr. Rehan.
And the difference between AS and MR, the thing is that whenever we are performing echocardiography, we are not entirely dependent on single modality. We are trying to gather the information from all the available modalities and ultimately try to attain a certain decision. Just merely observing the shape of the envelope or the extent of the envelope, this may be a tough job to differentiate between the two. But the basic principle is that in case of MR, the trace is more broad. In case of AS, the trace is more narrow.
Hello, systolic.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That is one important thing.
Another point may be that in case of MR, the characteristic shape is a bell shape. But in case of AS, the shape is rather bullet shaped or dagger shaped.
But Manohar, can I
yes.
Before going for your question, I will give you the option. Regarding the envelope of AS and MR, in case of LVOT obstruction, we know that there is a dagger shaped or late systolic one. In case of mitral valve prolapse also, you get a late systolic one. So this will be similar one. And regarding the shape, there are many other things which can vary between. But one important thing probably is the initiation of the spectrum. In case of mitral regurgitation, it initiates immediately after the tip of the R wave. That means during the isovolumic contraction period, the MR starts. The AS starts after the end of isovolumic contraction. This is one important thing which sometimes can help us to differentiate. On that case, you have to go for the distance from R wave to the LVOT spectrum difference and the R wave to the spectrum you are in question.
And here lies all the importance of ECG getting.
ECG right. getting, exactly. This is one of the way how you can differentiate yes. MR and ASAP. We have got two distinguished panelists with us. One of is Dr. Prabir Kumar Das. Sir, please go with your question or comments.
Thank you, Manohar.
Welcome, sir.
Manohar.
Yes, sir.
Khub sundor bhabe present korechen ebong entertainment is so nice. Amra dawat dawar shomoy onekei boli je amar bashay ektu ashben ektu chatta dalbat khiye jaben. Manohar er ending ta chilo hocche dalbat khiye jaben boleche kintu entertainment hoyeche manushke entertainment koreche kintu biryani polao ebong joto unnato maner khabar ache sokole diye. So thank you, Manohar, very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yes.
Sir. You are my first teacher in the cardiology ward. Ward number 23 under Professor Jamal.
Thank you. In the third year.
Sir Mujumdar sir, you and Khaled Mohsin sir.
Yes.
My
yes,
first teachers.
So I feel proud of you. Both.
Thank you, sir.
Professor Mujumdar, he was my teacher also. You as you. যখন হার্ট ব্রেক একটু বাংলায় বলি যখন এত খবর আসে আমাদের প্রিয়জন অনেকেই আমাদের ছেড়ে চলে যাচ্ছে মনটা খুব খারাপ হয়ে যায় কিছুদিন আমাদের একজন অ্যাসোসিয়েট প্রফেসর আমাদের ছেড়ে চলে গেছেন মেডিকেলে কিন্তু পরবর্তীতে আবার কিছুক্ষণ পরেই পরবর্তী কয়েক ঘন্টার মধ্যে কিংবা তারপর দিন আবার যখন রবীন্দ্রনাথের কথা মনে করি তার কাছ থেকে আমরা সান্ত্বনা পাওয়ার চেষ্টা করি আছে দুঃখ আছে কষ্ট বিরহ বেদন লাগে তবুও শান্তি তবুও সুখ তবু আনন্দ মাগে এগুলি আমাদের এটা নিয়েই চলতে হবে তো এই ধরনের প্রেজেন্টেশনের পরে আরও আশাবাদী হওয়ার ইচ্ছে হয় আমরা ভবিষ্যতে আরও ভালো ভালো নতুন জিনিস আসবে আমাদের প্রেজেন্টার্স লাইক মনোয়ার অ্যান্ড আদার্স প্রেজেন্ট মোর অ্যান্ড মোর উইল নোয়িং মোর অ্যান্ড মোর তাহলে একটু বলি হচ্ছে আমরা যখন স্টুডেন্ট ওয়েন ইউ আর স্টুডেন্ট দেয়ার আর ওনলি ওয়ান ডাপলার ইন বাংলাদেশ দ্যাট ওয়াজ ডাপলার ইকোকার্ডিওগ্রাম বাই অলোকা ইন প্রজেক্ট আমরা সেই আমলের ছাত্র
থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার
সেকেন্ডলি আমাদের টিচার মজুমদার স্যার এটার নাম দিয়েছেন ফ্রাইডে ইকো তো আমার মনে পড়লো আমি কয়েকটা রুগীর ইকো করি প্রত্যেক শুক্রবারে করতাম আর কি আমার নিজের রুগী যেগুলো আমার খুব ইন্টারেস্টিং মনে হয় আমি কোনো ইকো করি না বেসিক্যালি তো সে হিসেবে দেখলাম যে না স্যার আমাকে নতুন করে আবার মনে করে দিয়েছেন ওই যে মানে ইউজুয়াল টাইমে যখন ফ্রাইডে সেটা আজকে নতুন করে আবার সকালে মনে করলাম
থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার
আর কি হচ্ছে আরেকটু সময় নেব এক মিনিট
জি
স্যার হচ্ছে যে কয়েকটা ইফেক্ট সম্বন্ধে মনোর খুব সুন্দর করে বলেছেন বিয়ার্ড এন্ড চিন ইফেক্ট আমার কাছে ভালভুলার হার্ট জন্য মূল মানে মানে টু স্টার্ট তার উল্টাটা হচ্ছে ফাংশনাল এমআর যদি আমরা গ্রেড 4 বলি এটা অ্যাকচুয়ালি হয়তো গ্রেড 3 এই জাতীয় আর একজন প্রেজেন্টার বলেছেন যে এএসআর এমআর এর একটা প্রসঙ্গ এসেছিল সামটাইমস দ্য স্পেকট্রাম অফ ম্যাটেরিয়াল ডিগ্রেডেশন মে বি কন্টামিনেটেড বাই প্রেজেন্স অফ কোএক্সিস্টিং এস তাহলে এমআর এর স্পেকট্রাম হচ্ছে হোলোসিস্টোলিক এবং ইউনিফর্ম এজ অলরেডি মেনশন বাই ফিরোজ অলসো আর যদি এস থাকে এট দ্য বিগিনিং অফ এমআর একটা পিক হবে এট দ্য এন্ড অফ এমআর আরেকটা পিক হতে পারে তো আমাদের উই শুড বি কেয়ারফুল হোয়েদার এস স্পেকট্রাম ইজ কন্টামিনেটিং এমআর ইন এ পেশেন্ট হু হ্যাভ কোএক্সিস্টেন্স দিস টু ডিজিজেস সো ফাইনালি আরেকটা প্রশ্ন ছিল হচ্ছে ম্যাটাল বালবুলার ডিজিজ ম্যাটাল স্টেনোসিস আর অ্যাওটিক স্টেনোসিস এই দুটোর মধ্যে ক্লেডিমেট্রি কমফোর্টেবলি করা যায় ইন কেস অফ ম্যাটাল স্টেনোসিস বাট ইজ ডিফিকাল্ট ইন কেস অফ অ্যাওটিক স্টেনোসিস আমার কাছে যেটা মনে হয় যে ম্যাটাল যেটা দুইটা বাল্বের অ্যানাটমিক্যাল ওরিয়েন্টেশন তো ভিন্ন একটা এনফেস দেখা যায় একটা প্রোফাইল দেখা যায় তাহলে প্রোফাইল ভিউ যদি না হয় তাহলে প্লেনমেন্টটি ভালো হবে না ম্যাটাল স্টেনোসিস বলে পুরো ওরিফিসটা ভালোভাবে দেখা যায় কিন্তু অ্যাওটিক স্টেনোসিস অ্যাওটিক বাল্বের অ্যানাটমিক্যাল লোকেশনটাই পজিশনটাই এমন যেটা প্রোফাইল ভিউ ভালো আছে না এটা এনফেস দেখা যায় সুতরাং এনফেস যেটা ভিজুয়ালাইজ হয় সেক্ষেত্রে প্লেনমেন্টটি under view of very much help so other ways to get adapted so first of all thanks to everybody thanks to the presenter Manohar again and moderator Rose and my teacher Professor Majumdar thank you
sir probably we have got Professor Tuhinok madam with us madam are with us Professor Tuhinok
thank you Thank you, Mono, for a nice presentation. It was a really a brilliant presentation. And I'm very happy to hear that you make the thing so simple. I want to add one point. You have explained very clearly, but as it is the ABC of ECHO, so when you mentioned about the aortic wall TVI, you mentioned about the apical five chamber and apical long axis view. But in many cases of elderly, we get the maximum velocity in right parasternal long axis view. So exactly. We should try the right parasternal view because right yes, parasternal sir. View and occasionally suprasternal view give the best result and we get the maximum velocity mean gradient and accurate TVI. And as the point of planimetry, yes, aortic valve anatomy is very difficult. And as Dr. Shahabuddin mentioned, the in-face view. So 3D echo is the most reliable and accurate for measurement of aortic valve. Even transesophageal echo, but even then, 3D TV is the best for measurement of aortic valve area. Thank you, sir, everybody.
Thank you, madam, for your brilliant comment. I think we have got Dr. Kobiruzzaman, sir, with us. Sir, are you with us? Dr. Kobiruzzaman? Probably he has left us. Sir, we want some opinion or comments from you.
Yes, it's an excellent and wonderful presentation. Very repeated subjects in a very testy. Yes. What I have done, I am always afraid of these topics. I learned a lot. It's an excellent presentation and he had collected so many pictures and he had gone through so many authors and so many sites. It's a very intuitive and very laborious job. Excellent. Congratulations, Munar, for your excellent presentation.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
But what I want to say...
Yes, sir.
I mean, most of the time, I use some words that echo, imaging is camouflaging something. It's like from the beginning, whenever he used to drive the car, he used to see the rear view mirror to locate the car behind. It is needs some orientation, his brain. What is the exact location of the car? So imaging is like, So what I'll say, your visual estimation is very important. Regarding the MR and the aortic stenosis and mitral stenosis, mitral regurgitation, what I say, the LVOT obstruction in the setup of hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, at that time there is SAM and MR. These two images, spectral doctor, are very confusing. So it is better put your 2D and color and observe on and off and observe where you are. Are your continuous wave Doppler is along the LVOT or along the mitral? This is one technique. Another technique I used to apply in my practical life, I used to take an MR class and keep it in record. What is the shape of MR? What is the maximum density of MR? Then I go search for the LVOT obstruction. And definitely the MR velocity profile shape and LVOT spectral image is different. Then I go for the calculation of the LVOT, B not B, like this. This I want to add. Besides that, he has included a lot of things. Another issue, someone is questioned that peak gradient, instantaneous gradient, mean gradient. Actually, in cath lab, it is that you can go through the Catherine M. Otto, you can go through the Brownout, mention these things, they are confusing things. In cath lab, it is measured the peak to peak. It is not real time. But echo, it measures the instantaneous pressure gradient. So peak pressure gradient and the mean pressure gradient is same for echo and cath lab. But peak to peak pressure gradient is not similar. But ironically, in cath lab, they don't usually measure the mean gradient or peak instantaneous. That's the answer. There is some graph. If anyone interested, they can go through the graph. Then the concept will be more clear. So thank you for
giving
me to talk a few words regarding this. Thank you, sir. Muzindar, sir.
I have talked
about in that presentation. You are my great mentor. I have many recapitulation with you. I have not mentioned this.
But you are not following my advice always. Dr. Kobiran Jamal. তোমার আরো আরো একাডেমিক অ্যাক্টিভিটিস করতে হবে আরো করতে হবে আরো করতে হবে
স্যার নাও আই রিকোয়েস্ট প্রফেসর আব্দুল ওয়াদুদ চৌধুরী স্যার টু সে ফিউ ওয়ার্ডস প্রফেসর আব্দুল ওয়াদুদ চৌধুরী স্যার
অনুরোধ হলো কি সব সময় অসাধারণ সব প্রেজেন্টেশন তৈরি করে খুব ডিটেইল ফুল ইন ডেপথ আবার সেটাকে সহজ করে আনার প্রেজেন্ট করে আজকে তার কোনো ব্যতিক্রম না যেমন অনুরোধ এসছে যে এই লেকচারটা রেকর্ডটা ফেসবুকে অ্যাভেলেবল করা হবে কিনা কারণ সবারই আগ্রহ ওটা বারবার করে শোনা প্রয়োজন একবার শুনে কেউ মনে রাখতে পারবে না এত কিছু এবং এতে এত অসংখ্য ইম্পর্টেন্ট শেখার মতো পয়েন্ট আছে যারা বিশেষ করে ইকো করে থাকে তাদের জন্য এটা সাংঘাতিক হেল্পফুল হবে মনে রাখ খুব ভালো প্রেজেন্ট শুনেছে আমি যেটা আরেকটা জিনিস চাই এটা ফিরোজ মনে তোমাদের সবার কাছ থেকে তোমরা একটা প্রেজেন্টেশন তৈরি করো যে মাইটাল ভালভুলার ডিজিজ দেখার সময় সেটা মাইটাল স্টেনোসিস হোক রিগার্ডেশন ইত্যাদি হোক কমন কি কি এরর করি আমরা জাস্ট এটা মানে আমাদের কমন যে আমরা খেয়াল করি না দেখে ভুল হয় আমি যেমন সেদিন বলছিলাম কোন একটা ইয়েতে যে আজকাল ছেলেপেলেরা কিন্তু মাইটাল স্টেনোসিসের লিটারেরি কোনো বর্ণনাই দিতে পারে না কারণ সবাই কাগজের মধ্যে এই সই করা টিক চিহ্ন দেওয়ার মতো রিপোর্ট করে তার ফলে তার কিন্তু অ্যাসেসমেন্ট অফ দ্য ভাগ যেটা সেটা যে বলার যে অভ্যাসটা সেটা যে তার আইডিয়েশনটা সেটা কিন্তু মনের মধ্যে তৈরি হয় না ওর কিন্তু টিক চিহ্ন তৈরি হয় টিক চিহ্ন কিন্তু আসলে অ্যাকচুয়াল নলেজের স্থলাভিষিক্ত হতে পারে না দুই নম্বর হলো আমি প্রচুর দেখি যেমন এই যে এই পেশেন্টগুলো ডক্টর ইকো করছে মাইটাল ভালভ এরিয়া যেমন আমরা জানি তার গোল্ড স্ট্যান্ডার্ড হলো প্লেনিমেট্রিতে ভালভ এরিয়া প্রচুর রিপোর্ট দেখবো আমরা প্রেশার হাফ টেন্ডি একটা রিপোর্ট দেওয়া আছে প্লেনিমেট্রি কোনো উল্লেখই নেই মানে তার অ্যাওয়ারনেস এর মধ্যে নাই যে কোনটা গোল্ড স্ট্যান্ডার্ড আর কোনটা হলো সাপোর্টিং কোন জায়গাতে আমি প্রেশার হাফ টাইমের উপর বেশি জোর দিব যে যখন আমার ক্লাসিফিকেশন আছে, আর কোন জায়গাতে আমার আইডিয়ালি আসলে এটার উপর দেওয়া উচিত। আবার এমন দেখি যে পেশেন্টের দেখা যায় একটা ভালো করে লিশন আছে, দেখা গেল পালমোনারি আর্টারির প্রেশার একেবারেই নর্মাল। এটা যে যে কোনো কারণ হোক, সে জেট মানে টিআরজে ঠিক মতো ধরতে পারে নাই সেজন্য হয় নাই, সেটা না। কারণ সিভিয়ার মাইটাল স্টেনোসিস থাকলে পালমোনারি হাইপারটেনশন থাকবে না, এটা হতে পারে না, ফিজিওলজিক্যাল না। কিন্তু এই যে ভুলগুলা, এই অ্যাওয়ারনেস এর মধ্যে না, আমরা প্রত্যেকটা ইন্ডিভিজুয়াল কম্পোনেন্ট শেখার পরে আমি কিন্তু এইরকম চমৎকার লেকচার তোমাদের দুজনের কাছ থেকে আশা করব। স্যার আপনাকে ধন্যবাদ এই যে পুরো আয়োজনটা আপনি করছেন। মজুমদার স্যার জয় তো আপনার, মনোয়ার ফিরোজ জয় তো তোমাদের।
অদ্ভুত অদ্ভুত স্যার, অদ্ভুত। তুমি আপনি বললা কেন, আমরা বল সবাই বেসিক্যালি খুব ভালো করে শিখুক, এবং এই যে মনোয়ার বা ফিরোজ বা এরা যে আমাদেরকে সারপাস করে গেছে,
শাহানা আছে, কবিরুজ্জামান আছে, আপনি কবিরুজ্জামান ভাই কি ধরছেন একদম ঠিক,
এই যে আমাদের অদ্ভুত এরা যে আমাদেরকে সারপাস করে যাচ্ছে, গেছে বহু সারপাস, এটা কিন্তু এর জন্য আমরা খুব গর্বিত, বিকজ পার্ট অফ দ্য ক্রেডিট ইজ অলসো বিলং টু মি, বিলং টু ইউ, এটা মনে করি আর কি, যে তাদের যে ক্রেডিট তার কিছু আমরা পাই, তো এর জন্য আমরা গর্বিত, তাই না? কাজে আমরা, আমার মনে হয় তোমরা আমি এটা না, আমরা।
থ্যাংক ইউ, থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার, থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার। উই হ্যাভ গট প্রফেসর তৌফিকুর রহমান, Govindupal, Anisur Rahman, maybe Abdul Salam, if you have got any comment you can make. Professor Taufik? Chunde Pachina, Taufik?
Can you hear me?
Yes, 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 Shunaj, tell
me. Okay, thank you Monohar for his brilliant presentation as usual. Actually, I'm going to teach you something else. ওই নতুন কিছু নতুন ইয়েতে আসলে অনেক কিছু শিক্ষণীয় এবং সহজভাবে শিক্ষণীয়, যেটা অদ্ভুত স্যার উল্লেখ করলেন যে খুব সহজভাবে ওনার ডিসক্রাইব করছে। থ্যাংক ইউ ভেরি মাচ।
আসসালামুআলাইকুম,
ওয়ান্ডারফুল প্রেজেন্টেশন এন্ড এক্সিলেন্ট, আমি খুব এনজয় করেছি। আমার আসলে চিটং এর জন্য রিকোয়েস্ট ছিল ফিরোজ ভাইয়ের কাছে একদিনের একটা ইকো প্রোগ্রাম আর কি, তো সেটা ওই যে তিন মাস ব্যাপী হচ্ছে, সেটা আমি খুব খুশি। এবং আমি মজুমদার স্যারকে থ্যাংকস জানাতে চাই এই এই বিষয়ে, কারণ এটা একদিনে শেখার বিষয় না, যা আমি বুঝতে পারছি এখন। এবং আমি খুব খুশি যে আমার স্টুডেন্টরা প্রতিদিন এটা ওরা শিখতে পারছে, জানতে পারছে আর কি। বিশেষ করে বিভিন্ন যে ইকো প্রোগ্রামগুলো হয়, শুধু আমরা ফ্যাকাল্টিরা আসলে জয়েন করতে পারতাম, ওরা ঠিক অ্যাক্সেস ছিল না, তা এখন এই ওয়েবিনারের সুযোগে ওরা ঠিক একইভাবে শিখতে পারছে, এই জন্য আমি খুব খুশি। থ্যাংক ইউ ভেরি মাচ।
থ্যাংক ইউ। এটা অবশ্যই বলার জিনিস যে আনিস প্রথম আমাকে বলছিল যে চিটাগং এর জন্য একটা প্রোগ্রাম করতে, পরে আমি স্যারের সাথে কথা বলে ঠিক করলাম যে না, একদিনে তো কিছু শেখা যাবে না, এটা শুধু চিটাগং এর জন্য না করে সবার জন্য করা যায় কিনা, সেটার ফল হচ্ছে এটা। আশা করি আমাদের এটা পূর্ণতা পাবে। গোবিন্দ কিছু বলবা?
হ্যাঁ, থ্যাংক ইউ ফিরোজ ভাই, আর স্যার আব্দুল্লাহ শাফি মজুমদার স্যার, অল দ্য টিচার্স হিয়ার, all the viewers, extraordinary presentation, I think, and more difficult topics make it easy by Monohar, already said by our professor Abdullah Shafi Mazumdar sir. But one Thank thing you. I like to share during calculation of diastolic dysfunction, TR velocity, perception of TR velocity or calculation of TR velocity, we have seen the E by E ratio is adjusted with type grade 3 or grade 4 diastolic dysfunction, but TR velocity not perceived, TR velocity is not up to the mark, but why? I like to know if Monohar it can easy, but or
I think we will talk on diastolic.
Understand my question?
Yes, sir. We understand your question. I think we will discuss about diastolic dysfunction in another session.
Okay.
Join us, Professor Abdul Salam, okay. Sir. Professor ABM Abdul Salam.
Yeah. Thank you. Excellent. I am really
Ralam, you are next.
I am really spellbound. Actually, the basic of ECHO and its hemodynamic consideration and evaluation, actually it is a bioengineering. So a lot of things are coming from physics. So we usually avoid. আমি একটা এক্সাম্পল দিতে চাই, সেটা হচ্ছে যে একজন ড্রাইভার, ওয়াইনের ড্রাইভার, এই ড্রাইভার মে বি এ ভেরি গুড ড্রাইভার, বাট ইফ হ্যাজ নো আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ডিং অফ দি বেসিক্স অফ দি কার, দ্যাট কার ইঞ্জিন, হি উইল ফেল ইন সার্টেন পয়েন্ট অ্যান্ড ইট বিকামস অ্যাবনর্মাল। সো দিস ইজ ভেরি ইম্পর্টেন্ট অ্যান্ড ইট হ্যাজ বিন ভেরি সিম্পলিফাইড অ্যান্ড ওয়েল আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ডেবল বাই ডক্টর মনোয়ার। I salute to Manohar for his brilliant presentation. He touched every aspect, including the congenital ECHOs, and I think it was excellent. And I thank you, all of you, particularly Professor Mazumdar sir, Professor Adhut Chaudhary, and you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Dr. Noor Alam, in short.
Am I audible, Firoz bhai?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Firoz bhai. And Manohar bhai is a good presenter. It is not new thing. The new thing is that, as already we know that his brother is sick today, and some phone are coming before his presentation, we are seeing. So in this stress situation, how he concentrated this type of lecture is really amazing, really amazing. So congratulations, Manohar bhai. I would like to one thing. That you have mentioned very nicely that by VSD, if a VSD is present, then we can calculate the PSP, and in case of VSD, we can also can calculate the systolic pressure in the same way also, no?
Right.
Yes, exactly.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
We are almost at the end. Professor Shahabuddin sir, one of our distinguished panelists today. Professor Mohammed
thank you very much, first of all I like to give my thanks and heartfelt thanks to Manohar proved that he is not only a meritorious student in medical career but also a good teacher. He has explained very nicely and in depth and then brilliantly the ABC and also the advanced techniques of color Doppler imaging. This lecture was very much informative, both in basic and advanced things, and very precise. And very the thing is that he is very much fluent in his speech. There is no interruption in his speech. Simplicity and for this informative lecture, I again thanks to Manohar for his brilliant lecture. And at the same time, I would like to give thanks to Professor Shapur Mazumdar sir that he has taken me as a panelist in this session. Though I know very little about the basics of CECO, but still I am the panelist in this session. And from this session, I have truth that I have learned a lot. Thanks, Manohar. Thanks. My colleagues, Kovirit Jawan is there, and all the other colleagues are, and Dr. Tuhin Haq has nicely inputted these things. I think this is the, Mahmudullah, please, this is the right thing that we will discuss every the things, details in one lecture, and we will not amalgamate the other things that will be discussed in later on. So, we will be precise to the lectures, to this in depth for this session only.
Exactly.
So with this order, I would like to conclude here. Thank you very much for giving me the chance of being a panelist here. Thanks, sir.
Thank you, sir. Probably we are able to be focused today without that much of disruption.
আগের দিনের চেয়ে আজকে আমরা লেকচারে ফোকাস থাকতে পারছি। আগের সব দিনগুলো আমরা দেখছি যে আমাদের লেকচারের অন্যান্য সব যে সমস্ত লেকচারগুলো হবে সেগুলো আমরা একই সাথে বলার চেষ্টা করছি। আসলে এইভাবে না করে ইন ডেপথ একটার মধ্যে থাকলে পরবর্তী লেকচারে ওইগুলো আলাপ করলে ভালো হবে।
Yeah. So thank you. So for the attendees, we make all these lectures available to you in Facebook and probably in YouTube also in soon. And one request to you, please try to make more questions during the sessions. If you have any question regarding the previous lecture, you can also ask that in the next lecture. Now I request Professor Abdullah Shafi Mujumdar sir to conclude the session.
তো সবাইকে ধন্যবাদ দেই আমি ডক্টর মনোয়ার জি খুব ভালো লেকচার প্রেজেন্ট করলো এটা তো সবাই জানে আমার উদ্দেশ্য কিন্তু দুটো একটা হলো আমাদের জুনিয়র ডাক্তার যারা ফেলোস নভিস তাদেরকে আমরা যদি কিছু ইম্পার্ট করতে পারি আমরা তো শেখানোর ব্যাপার না টু ইম্পার্ট দি নলেজ এ টিচার ক্যান ইম্পার্টস দি নলেজ আর একটা হলো যে আমাদের ফ্যাকাল্টিও কিন্তু ডেভেলপ করতে হবে যেমন জানে যারা আমাদের যে গ্রুপটা জানছে পড়ছে তারা যে প্রেজেন্ট করতে হবে এই প্রেজেন্ট করার অভ্যাসটা তৈরি করতে হবে আমার মনে হয় আমরা যদি এই ধরনের প্রোগ্রামগুলি খালি অল্প সময়ের জন্য না সারা বছর ধরে যদি এই প্রোগ্রামগুলি থাকে তাইলে কিন্তু দুটো কাজই হয় যারা ফ্যাকাল্টি তারা তাদেরকে আরও শানিত করতে পারে আরও ভালো করতে পারে আমরা অনেক সময় বাইরের লেকচার থেকে অনেক সময় অভিভূত হই যে এত সুন্দর লেকচার তার মানে ওরা কিন্তু বিভিন্ন জায়গায় বিভিন্ন সময় দিয়ে যাচ্ছে কাজে আমাদের ফ্যাকাল্টিদেরও কিন্তু এই বিভিন্নভাবে এই লেকচার দেওয়ার একটা অভ্যাস তৈরি করতে যার জন্যে আমাদের ভবিষ্যতে এটা আমাদেরকে কাজে লাগবে কাজে আজকে আমি মনোয়ারকে ধন্যবাদ দিই ফিরোজ তো ভালো মনোয়ারটা সবসময় এবং তুমি অনেক ইনপুটও দিয়েছো এই প্রেজেন্টেশনে তোমাকেও ধন্যবাদ আমাদের দুইজন সম্মানিত প্যানেলিস্ট প্রফেসর শাহাবুদ্দিন এবং প্রফেসর কবির তারা ভালো ইনপুট দিয়েছে অন্যান্য যারা ফ্যাকাল্টি উপস্থিত ছিল প্রফেসর ওদু প্রফেসর তুহিন কবিরুজ্জামান প্রফেসর তৌফিক সবাই তো অনেক সুন্দর সুন্দর ইনপুট দিয়েছে কাজে আমার মনে হয় যে ভবিষ্যতে আমরা এই আমাদের এই সিরিজটা অব্যাহত রাখবো এবং আমি আশা করি যে নবিস যারা তারা এতে আরো ইন্টারেস্ট নিয়ে পার্টিসিপেট করবে তবে তাইলে আমাদের এই উদ্যোগটা সফল হবে এর সাথে আমি বেক্সিমকো ফার্মাসিউটিক্যালকে আমি ধন্যবাদ জানাই পার্টিকুলারলি আমাদের যিনি সরি কি বলে ওর নাম রাজীব জামশিদুল হাসান রাজীব আমি পুরো নামটা বলতে চাচ্ছিলাম ডাক্তার জামশিদুল হাসান রাজীব সে খুবই সিনসিয়ারলি আমাদের এই প্রোগ্রামের সাথে অ্যাটাচ এবং আমি তাকেও ধন্যবাদ জানাই বেক্সিমকোকে ধন্যবাদ জানাই এবং সবাইকে সুস্থ থাকেন ভালো থাকেন এই প্রার্থনা করে আমি শেষ করছি খোদা হাফেজ সবাইকে ধন্যবাদ
ইরোজ নেক্সট লেকচারটা বলে দিবা
থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার
ওটা আমরা বোধহয় জানিয়ে দিব ওদের